Hi, everybody. Father Frisoni with you. Greetings and thanks for joining us. Well, we have a little reprieve this week, weather-wise. Now, don't tell my mother. Shh. No earmuffs. 46 degrees and sun trying to pierce the clouds, so not too bad this week. We've been pummeled so far in 2021, so we need a little reprieve. I hope you're doing great, and I wanted to share with you a few reflections that I've had to encounter in the past few weeks involving stays at various hospitals. A number of people have lost their mothers, their fathers, their relatives who have had to go to hospital to get better, but it did not happen that way, and may they rest in peace. And so many persons found themselves in the regular rooms or in the intensive care units. And as you know, we are certainly battling the insidious virus, the epidemic that we find ourselves engaged in this battle. And because we are with this illness, there are certain regulations that do not permit families to be with loved ones as before the epidemic, such as in the waiting rooms or even in their patient rooms. And so this is very difficult for family members. And so the person who is sick goes from here to here. The person that died, may they rest in peace, went from the hospital eventually to the cemetery without their relatives or friends being able to visit them in the hospital room before they died. And a number of people have told me about an anguish, a hole in the heart, to lose someone so close without any notice that there begins some kind of malady that may or may not be related to the current virus, but some problem on an acute basis begins, and they deteriorate rapidly in the hospital, and there is no ability to visit to say goodbye to their loved one. And so we must reflect this week about the judgment process in light of the virus, but also in light of the need for emotional support and comfort. And so it's worth a reflection on what is the judgment process. What are the goods that we have to judge as people of God? Obviously, it is important to stay as healthy and as safe as possible. We don't want to get sick, and we don't want anybody else to get sick. And so we have to be most careful how we keep our distance from people so that we are not spreading something that we really don't know too much about right now, except that for some people it's a very deadly bug. And so the first good that we try to uphold is to keep everybody safe and healthy. That's one side of the coin, one good. But there's also another good that we have to consider: comfort and love for one's mother, one's father, one's husband, or one's wife. Are you aware of the difficulty of losing a loved one when being unable to say goodbye before they fell asleep in the Lord? That could lead to a variety of challenges later on in life, but especially having to live with the fact that I could never say goodbye to my loved one in the hospital. Now, of course, if there was a sudden accident, may God forbid, then there would not be any ability whatsoever to say a goodbye in a hospital. But when there is a lag time of a few days, maybe a week or two, or a month when someone is in intensive care, yet the new rules may be that one cannot enter the hospital to say goodbye. That is a very, very difficult response. And so that's the second good to weigh, that There needs to be a bond and a connection with someone, even if we haven't been able to say that during the living years, that we are able to say that right at the very end. And I know that's not possible in every situation. Two goods to balance then. Good number one, the good of staying safe and healthy, but the second good of being close to one's loved one and being able to say goodbye, that they are close and that the only experience for that person and for you is not going to be at just the cemetery, being able to pray, because it's so hard to lose one's mother and one's father or any loved one. And so in the judgment process, I hope you realize by now there are two goods that have to be weighed, and that the selection is not 100% zero. That a selection of option one or option two will involve costs and benefits, and that there's not some precise answer that is 100% perfect. And we do that all of the time, but we don't realize that. The purpose of this week's promotion to the vision of our Lord with Peter and James and John on the mountain, along with the ancestors in faith, is to promote the view for us that we must include the Lord in our vision and in our judgment-making process. I am not a politician, and I am not a scientist. I'm just someone trying to shed the light of faith on a common problem that we have right now. Maybe there's some kind of concession or some kind of way to balance both of these goods so that we keep everybody safe and healthy, but that we allow somebody's son or daughter or husband or wife or sister or brother to have one last goodbye, especially if it is in intensive care and a person is close to falling asleep in the good Lord. There has to be these ways to weigh the options, but we do that with the eye toward the Lord who said, I have come that they may have life and life to the fullest. Do not be afraid of any kind of external force or fear or situation or even virus. Yes, we must be vigilant. Don't misunderstand. We must be precautious, but we must also put our cares on the good Lord, and that should something happen, the Lord will help us through the pain and the cross and the trial of that moment. And so in this weighing, we have to have a vision of Jesus near us, in front of us, and behind us while we weigh these various options. When we gaze on the mountain, we may see just trees or snow with the trees in this season. But I hope for a person of faith, you realize that the Lord is walking with us. And so that means that God must be part of the judgment-making process, and that the gospel of life that He has come to lift us up must be part of our decision-making and how we weigh life's challenges. And so none of us may be hospital executives, or maybe there might be someone tuning in, but we are all people of faith along the way, and we must pray for those who have to weigh these big decisions, but also with the possibility of knowing the pain and the hurt, the loss and the anger that someone experiences when a loved one leaves this earth and dies and is in the hands of God, but that relative must live on for years, maybe decades, nobody knows, only the good Lord, and that we must take into account that person as well, not just the virus. That we are all on this earth and journey together, and as people of God, we can come to a common solution, but based in love and based in care. And so I hope in your vision this week, if you have big decisions to weigh in your life, that you may incorporate the good Lord in those decisions. And don't be afraid to enter into the experience of God by direct prayer to God, not just something we do on a Sunday or as you're watching this broadcast here, for which we thank you, but that God is alive and all around you, Monday through Saturday and all the days of the week too. That the Lord guide your decisions and that you enter the heart and open the door of the heart to the good Lord. Peace be with you, everyone. Take good care. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the Lord be with you. As we travel with the Lord Jesus in the desert for our Lenten experience, we are joy-filled to be back together again at the table of the Lord. Greetings to all of our dear parishioners from Our Lady of Mount Carmel Parish and St. Adalbert Parish and St. Paul the Apostle Parish here in Schenectady, and wherever you may be tuning in from, a warm welcome and greeting to you in the good Lord. Let us acknowledge now our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. O God, who have commanded us to listen to your beloved Son, be pleased, we pray, to nourish us inwardly by your word, that with spiritual sight made pure, we may rejoice to behold your glory through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. A reading from the book of Genesis. God put Abraham to the test. He called to him, Abraham. Here I am, he replied. Then God said, take your son Isaac, your only one, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah. There you shall offer him up as a holocaust on a height that I will point out to you." When they came to the place of which God had told him, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. Then he reached out and took the knife to slaughter his son. But the Lord's messenger called to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he answered. "Do not lay your hand on the boy," said the messenger. "Do not do the least thing to him. I know now how devoted you are to God, since you did not withhold from me your own beloved son." As Abraham looked about, he spied a ram caught by its horns in the thicket. So he went and took the ram and offered it up as a holocaust in place of his son. Again, the Lord's messenger called to Abraham from heaven and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, that because you acted as you did in not withholding from me your beloved son, I will bless you abundantly and make your descendants as countless as the stars of the sky and as the sands of the seashore. Your descendants shall take possession of the gates of their enemies, and in your descendants all the nations of the earth shall find blessing. All this because you obeyed my command." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, if God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all, how will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen ones? It is God who acquits us. Who will condemn? Christ Jesus it is who died, or rather was raised, who is also at the right hand of God, who intercedes for us. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Cleanse my heart and my lips, Almighty God, that I may worthily proclaim your holy gospel.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Mark. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus took Peter, James, and John and led them up a high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his clothes became dazzling white, such as no fuller on earth could bleach them. Then Elijah appeared to them along with Moses, and they were conversing with Jesus. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Rabbi, it is good that we are here. Let us make three tents, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He hardly knew what to say, they were so terrified. Then a cloud came, casting a shadow over them. From the cloud came a voice, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." Suddenly, looking around, they no longer saw anyone but Jesus alone with them. As they were coming down from the mountain, he charged them not to relate what they had seen to anyone, except when the Son of Man had risen from the dead. So they kept the matter to themselves, questioning what rising from the dead meant. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Through the words of the Gospel, may our sins be wiped away. Well, we have a demonstration this week during homily time. To my left, there is one of our sanctuary chairs. These are very heavy chairs, and even heavier is the priest's chair in the other part of the sanctuary. So that was a little bit complicated to move before this filming. So we picked this chair. Suppose for a moment that you have this description of a chair in front of you. You have a chair made of wood, and there's certain fabric in it so that it's comfortable to sit in for longer periods of time, not just wood. And if you went up to someone to ask, "What is this piece of furniture?" the answer would be very obvious to most persons. "Why, this is a chair." And you'd be right. It is certainly a chair, and it's a very heavy one and sturdy, I might add. Beautiful chair. Now suppose for a moment that we had to discard of this chair because it was old, or it was in a flood, or something happened with the fabric. And we have our dumpsters outside of the parish church here. And I asked someone, "Oh, we have to get rid of the chair." And people would have no problem with that whatsoever. Can we discard of this chair? Of course, if we need to, we could get another one if it is beyond repair. It's just a chair. And now suppose for a moment we change the example just a little bit. Now, instead of this being an ordinary chair that the servers or others sat in the sanctuary, now we say, "This was Grandma Marjorie's chair that she sat in for 5 years before she died. And this was the chair that she phoned you from, that she watched television from, and that was her favorite chair in her house." Is it just a chair? Why, yes, of course, it is just a chair. Can it be discarded 2 weeks after Grandma Marjorie's death? If someone said, "Well, it doesn't look good. It may not rock correctly if it's a recliner. It has stains in it. Let's just get rid of it." Why not? It's just a chair. And you vehemently object, "Absolutely not. This is Grandma Marjorie's chair. How can you just get rid of it and discard it?" It's not just a chair. So is it a chair, or is it more than just a chair? That is a key experience before Jesus the Lord. Jesus is not just an ordinary man. but the living God. And so when we have ordinary objects, we may see them as just chairs. But there are some people who import a greater value to the ordinary object because they have a different vision of the meaning of that chair. Every single person in the human experience brings a different meaning to this particular chair. For many people, it's just a chair. But for Grandma Marjorie's relatives, that is far more than just a chair. And thus, every person has a contribution in the mind and in the heart about how to experience phenomena in our world and in the heart. And so, as we see Jesus our Lord on the mountain, these are with eyes of faith and not necessarily human eyes. Because after all, when Jesus ascended the mountain with Peter and James and John, this was a grand vision for those three apostles that would change their lives forever. It wasn't just the mountain. For them, something sacred happened in their vision on that mountain, and that changed forever their vision of the Lord. If Grandma Marjorie passes away, may she rest in peace. There are some people who want to hold her very, very close based on their vision and their memories of Grandma Marjorie. Memory is the key to understanding the transfiguration of our Lord. Many scholars see that the rich mystery of the transfiguration is not meant so much to tell us about Jesus, but it was Jesus who brought Peter, James, and John to see something that they did not see before. The event was for them, not for Jesus. Christ knew who he was. He was the Son of God. This was for Peter and James and John, the apostles. And when they came down that mountain, after they saw the connection of our Lord with the ancestors of faith in the past, they were startled. They wondered what resurrection was all about. What is this rising from the dead business? How can we rise from the dead? And then it all became clearer later. Just the chair. But if your Grandma Marjorie was in that chair, it's far more than just an object, and certainly not an object that could be discarded, at least not the first 2 weeks after Grandma Marjorie passed away. That it is something you want to hold on to. You want to embrace this. Because if Grandma Marjorie has fallen asleep and is buried, this is one of the fondest memories that you will have of her and the recall that you will experience from a mother, a father, a loved one, a husband or a wife, a dear relative. She was always there. And now she's in a different way with us. But this is a memory, and this observation triggers something in the heart. And so it is with Jesus. You and I have a memory. We were not on the physical mountain, but what we see at the altar of Calvary is not just bread and wine. It is really Jesus who is connected with us in the mystery of the incarnation, God becoming man, in order that our hearts may be elevated to a new vision with God. Pope Benedict taught this about the transfiguration. And I quote, "Jesus wants this light to illuminate our hearts when they pass through the thick darkness of his passion and death, when the folly of the cross becomes unbearable to us, God is light, and Jesus wishes to give his closest friends the experience of this light, which dwells within him. It takes a vision to know that this is not just a chair, but that this is something special. And it takes a vision and faith for us to realize that at the altar, it's not just bread and wine, but truly Jesus. Down the mountain, descending the sacred place to be with us in our sacred places, right before us in our homes, in our music, even in the homily, if you can believe it, in all aspects of our sacred worship, wherever we may be, and especially in prayer and in our connections. This is the way we keep Jesus close, just like by keeping sacred objects of Grandma Marjorie, your grandfather, or your husband, may they rest in peace. You are keeping them close to the heart. And though they may have fallen asleep, they are close. And Jesus has died, he's risen, and ascended to the Heavenly Father. But he is close, because we give a great value to the observations we have made in faith, the observation of the sacrifice at the altar. This is that experience of the transfiguration. It's about transforming us into disciples of faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. For enlightenment on our Lenten journey, that as we participate in sacrificial practices during this Lenten season, we may make more room in our life for God, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For all whose faith is weak, that like Abraham, God will renew our spirits and guide us in relying upon him, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For those in our community preparing for the sacraments of initiation, Michelle, Taylor, Kevin, Wilfred, Jennifer, Jordan, Jennifer, Jael, and Jada, that they might find our support and encouragement as they journey toward Christ and his church, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For all recovering from winter storms, that God will protect them from harm, restore their utilities, and make available the resources that they need, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For all who are suffering, that the Lord will give courage and strength to those who call upon him, open job possibilities for the unemployed, and give peace to those who are grieving, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. For the prayer intentions
of Michael Glances, for whom Mass is applied today, we pray, Lord, hear our prayer. For the repose of the souls of Vincenzo Grasso and Giuseppina Grasso, Josephine and Domenico Del Veneri, Ermita, Joseph, and Richard De Cesare, Elsie Stenard, Leanne Stenard, Peter and Catherine Morawski, Mary Lou Massaroni, John Massaroni, Robert Massaroni, Carmela Aprizesi, Richard Bonagura, Barbara Judd, Joseph Sakela, Debbie Stilson, Karen Segreto, Robert Sheehan, Janet and Chet Granato, deceased trainer family members, Michael Anthony Jude Kubik, Robin Barnett, John M. Iini, Marianne Cook, and Mark Cook. For these souls and the souls of all the faithful departed, that they may rest in the peace of our loving God, we pray. Lord, hear our prayer. And for what else in silence shall we offer to the living God as petition of the heart this day? We pray, Lord, hear our prayer. We ask you, Lord, to grant these prayers through Christ the Lord. Amen. Sisters, pray that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. May the Lord accept the sacrifice at my hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. May this sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults and sanctify your faithful in body and mind for the celebration of the Paschal festivities. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts, and let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For after he had told the disciples of his coming death, on the holy mountain he manifested to them his glory to show, even by the testimony of the law and the prophets, that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so, with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth, and before your majesty without end we acclaim.
Thank you. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We eat this bread and drink this cup. We proclaim the Lord until you come again.
Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly, we pray that partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Edward Scharfenberger, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace. Peace be with you, everyone. eternal life to us who receive it. This, your most holy body and blood, from all my sins and from every evil. Keep me always faithful to your commandments, and never let me be parted from you. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. May the body of Christ keep me safe for eternal life. Let us pray. As we receive these glorious mysteries, we make thanksgiving to you, O Lord, for allowing us, while still on earth, to be partakers even now of the things of heaven, through Christ our Lord. In thanksgiving for you joining us for this journey with the Lord through the desert and into the Eucharistic mystery, I hope and pray that you may have the vision of our Lord and the vision that he gives us of him in order to see things differently in life, so that any trial you may understand that the Lord is walking with us and that it is not just a chair, but that there is more meaning and import that is given to us by our loving God. And so have a wonderful week and entrust your trials and tribulations to the good Lord, and he will set you free. Keep watching for him. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.